Hello, everyone, and welcome to our worship service at Holy Trinity Lutheran Church in New Prague, Minnesota. It is such a gift to be here with you on this lovely day. So wherever you're watching from, in whatever time you're watching at, we just feel so honored that you are here and that you're making worship a part of your day. If you're just joining us, we are in a sermon series right now on the Ten Commandments. So we've gone through the first three commandments, and today we will be diving deep and taking a look at the fourth commandment. So thank you for being here, and without further ado, we begin worship in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Welcome to worship.
A reading from Ephesians, the sixth chapter. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may be well with you and you may live long on earth. And fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Slaves, obey your earthly masters with fear and trembling in singleness of heart as you obey Christ, not only while being watched and in order to please them, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. Render the service with enthusiasm, as to the Lord and not to men and women, knowing that whatever good we do, we will receive the same again from the Lord, whether we are slaves or free. And masters, do the same to them. Stop threatening them, for you know that both of you have the same master in heaven, and with him there is no partiality. The word of the Lord.
I want to begin today by asking if you've ever heard someone say any of these phrases or said them yourself. I prefer to practice my faith on my own. Or, I'm not connected to a church. I find my relationship with God is stronger when I practice it independently. Or, I get more out of my faith when I'm alone with God out in nature. Now, I want to begin with some compassion for these statements, because I myself have found it inspiring when I've read my Bible alone in the early hours of the morning. I too have experienced the messiness of being a part of a church and all the humanness that's found inside. And similarly, I have experienced the beauty and the stillness of God out in nature. But the trouble with each of these statements about faith is they're all about a relationship with me and God. They're all about a relationship with me and God. Well, today we're at this turning point in our sermon series about the Ten Commandments. Up to this point, we've had the first three. We've talked about, you shall have no other gods, you shall not misuse the name of the Lord, and remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Some people refer to these as the first table of commandments. They're all about a relationship between me and God and how we can love God. But today we turn the page to what some call the second table. The next seven commandments have to do with how we love our neighbor. So some like to use the image of the cross when we think about these two pieces of the Ten Commandments. So the first three having to do with the vertical part of the cross, and the next seven having to do with the horizontal part of the cross. Well, as you may recall, when Jesus was asked, which of these commandments is most important? Jesus said, first, love God with all your heart, soul, and mind. And secondly, love your neighbor as yourself. Which kind of covers all 10 of these commandments. Well, today's the day we turn the page to this second set of commandments. And we begin, as we learn about loving our neighbors, with first loving our parents. The fourth commandment today is honor your father and your mother. And as we think about these Ten Commandments, we know they come in two places of Scripture. If you're looking in the Exodus list, it's in chapter 20, verse 12, where it talks about honoring your father and mother. And I feel a need to begin today by just acknowledging that I know some of you and your families quite well. And I know that for some of you, you have really wonderful relationships with your mom or dad or parents. And I also know some of you have had some significant struggles and pain. So because of this, I want to frame our message today in two parts. The first being what I believe this commandment is not. And then secondly, what I believe this commandment is. So what it's not and what it is. So let's start with what it's not. And we have to think about this with context in mind of where these commandments were given. Because these commandments came to a community that had been redeemed from slavery under a really oppressive ruler in Egypt. At the very beginning of the commandments, God acknowledges the purpose of these commandments by beginning with God's own identity. God says, "I'm the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery." It's like God's wanting to remind God's people that God took them out of this difficult place and is now trying to help in creating some things to guide this new way of free life. It's like God reminds God's people who he is. He's a God of deliverance, of saving, of protection, of provision. So these commandments are intended to promote well-being in this new way of life with God as their leader. But I think it must be said today that those who have experienced abuse from a parent, this commandment isn't any way justification for that abuse. The Israelites, who God gave these commandments to, they knew pain and hurt from someone with authority. And God clarified at the beginning of the commandments that this was not the way when God was leading. God's a God who hears us when we call, who listens, who saves, who redeems, who provides. And God reminds us that time and time again, and just one more time does that at the beginning of these commandments. So as we think about what this commandment is not, it is not justification for abuse. So what is it then? Well, the word honor, I had fun doing a bit of a word study on that. The original Hebrew literally means to make heavy. It means to make heavy. And when I was doing this word study, I pictured looking across the road at a neighbor carrying something really heavy. And just that feeling of when you watch someone trying to carry something heavy, when you feel compelled and you want to help. This word honor, to make heavy, can also be understood as weighty or valuable or important, a priority. It's to make heavy. So I think as we think about this in the context of honoring a mother or father, it means to make it a priority, or it's valuable or important. And I want to wonder about this today with you, because I think we may have it backwards. We often think about the Ten Commandments and offer them and teach them to children. And I wonder if it's not just as, or maybe even more important, that we think about these as adults. You know, a lot of scholars, when they dig into this particular commandment, emphasize how it relates to elders or care for elder parents. And part of this is because from what we can gather, these commandments were given to adults. They were given to adults, they addressed adult topics, and likely they were also given to male adults as we think about the context and the grammar that's used. So with that audience in mind and recognizing who they were first given to, we have to also not box out ourselves from being able to hear what they might say to us, as all scripture can. So when I wonder about, well, what does this really mean in daily life? What does it mean to honor our parents? Whenever we wonder something like that, I think it's helpful to let scripture interpret itself and just to look in the broader picture of scripture for some examples of where we might see that. And as I was digging into this week, there were a few character examples that one scholar, Patrick Miller, had mentioned. And I want to share them with you today. And I think the first one, which was a bit of an unexpected one for me, was Ruth. As we think about Ruth, Ruth was a daughter-in-law who walked with her mother-in-law, Naomi. Naomi had lost her two sons, they had died, and Ruth, as her daughter-in-law, made a commitment to stay by her side, to care for her, walk with her, and accompany her. I think she was one example of honoring a mother or father. Another completely different example might be Joseph. As we think about the story of Joseph, we know Joseph wasn't treated well by his brothers, but eventually down the road in his life, he was in a place to be able to provide and care for his dad and his family in the midst of a big famine. So Joseph is one more example of honoring a mother or father. And lastly, I want to picture with you when Jesus is on the cross. When he's hanging on the cross and he looks down, he sees his mom and a disciple who he loved. And he told to his mom, he said, "Woman, here's your son." And then he told the disciple, "And here's your mother." So even when he was facing death, Jesus wanted to honor his mom. Well, I began today by asking if you've ever heard people say some of these statements about faith. And these phrases that we talked about all refer to an individual relationship with God and how a life of faith might be lived out that way. But as we study the fourth commandment and we turn the page to these next set of commandments having to do with others, we learn we can't stay there. Our life of faith, at least within the Judeo-Christian tradition, cannot be just about me and God. Because right from the get-go, God uses 7 of the 10 commandments to talk about how we're called to love others, love our neighbor. So as we think about this today, as we begin turning the page to the second set of commandments that have to do with others, our neighbor, we begin by reading about how we're called to love our parents. Well, after this, in the next 6 weeks, as we talk about the rest of the commandments, they're all going to be about thou shalt not. They're all things we shouldn't do in order to care for the well-being of others. But today is the one commandment we get that deals with how to love other people that says what we should do. And it has to do with parents. It's not about making a lot of money or having power or leadership. It's not about being fruitful and multiplying. The one commandment we get about what we should do for or with others is to honor parents. Well, before I close today, I want to acknowledge that I know a lot of you are honoring parents right now. I know many of you who are accompanying to appointments, who are shopping for supplies, who are prioritizing caregiving in your calendars. And what I hope you'll hear from the message today is that I believe what you're doing is a calling from God. I believe it's a calling and an important calling from God. It's the first commandment God gave as a way of loving our neighbor, beginning with our parents. So as we learn today to see faith as more than just between me and God, today we're invited to learn how to love our neighbor by honoring our parents, right where it all began. Let's pray. Thank you, Heavenly God, for being our eternal parent. As we seek to honor our earthly parents, we pray that the parents in our midst can strive to be honorable with your help. And God, we pray that as we seek to make a difference in our world, that we don't look past or forget about those who brought us into the world in the beginning. God, thank you and bless our parents. Amen.
Hi. As Toby and I were recording the song for this week, How Great Thou Art, we received word of the passing of Dr. Lynn Lauderdale. Doc was our choral director and music professor at the University of West Florida. And she was always so supportive of us in our music careers, but also us as people. She was also a deeply faithful woman. So we would like to dedicate this performance to her today. We love you, Doc.
Oh, Lord, my God. Who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day
our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those
who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Hello, my name is Karen Taylor, and on behalf of all of the staff here at Holy Trinity, I'd like to thank you for joining us for worship. Here at Holy Trinity, it is our mission to share God's love with all people from one generation to the next. I'd like to highlight a few ways that you can help us do this. Number one, our Strategic Plan 2.0 huddle is happening this afternoon. If you're watching us on Sunday morning, make sure you come to church this afternoon. The huddle starts at 4 p.m. Donna and her crew are going to be cooking a great meal and serving us up. And we're going to have some entertainment by the Holy Trinity Choir. Yay, we haven't heard them sing for over 18 months. So that is going to be a great treat. Now, also, you're going to be hearing from all of the 5 team leads that are bringing their ideas forward, and they're going to be leading us into some uncharted territory and moving Holy Trinity forward, taking that Vision 2020 process and moving it forward. We're also having a guest speaker, Pastor Blair Anderson. Now, those of you who are around for the strategic plan, the original version, Pastor Blair was the one that helped us kind of get this process started. So he's coming back. So that'll be great to hear from him, and to maybe he'll give us a little report card on how we were doing on the first one. So it'll be a great afternoon. Don't worry, it's going to be outside, so you don't have to worry about any sort of COVID precautions. We will be under a tent, and so even if it's a little bit dreary outside, we will be protected. So make sure you check out that website. If you haven't RSVP'd yet, go ahead and go click that RSVP button, so that way we have a tally of how many people to expect. Now, another great way you can help spread the mission is with our new sign.
Around 10,000 vehicles pass the church each day, and a new sign would brighten up the entryway. With church news and announcements on display, we're asking for your help so that we can pay.
Now, we've been talking about this sign for about a month now, and we're collecting donations. If you look at this sign tracker, the more of the background that you can see, that is how many donations we've received. So if there's a black little square, that is still donations we are waiting to bring in. Now, this past week, we had a tremendous donation. It was $10,000, just one donation of $10,000, but we still have a little bit left to go. So keep bringing in those donations, and we can't wait to unveil this sign for everybody to see. Now, another great way to spread the mission is through our radio broadcast ministry. This happens weekly on our local K-Check radio station. And this week, the broadcast is sponsored by an anonymous donor. So thank you so much. Now, if you'd like to sponsor a week, make sure you contact Jamie in the church office, and she will let you pick whatever week you want. Maybe you have an anniversary, there's a birthday, there's something that you would like to honor, or somebody that you'd like to memorialize with this sponsorship. Jamie can help you out with that. And then I'd like to remind you that there is a new HTLC Connections, and in that issue, there is a great article written by Rose Fife. She's our communications specialist, among many other talents she shares with our HTLC community. She's highlighting the huddle, and so you can read that great article. It gives you a little bit of behind the scenes of how this huddle came about. And also, there's articles about the church buzz and COVID updates and different missions that you can take part in. Lastly, I'd like to remind you of how you can donate your offering to Holy Trinity. The first way is you can mail your offering in to the church office. Jamie collects the mail daily, and so you don't have to worry about any sort of security issues that way. The second way you can do is simply giving. Now, that is personally how I do it. I love it because it automatically is withdrawn, so I don't have to frantically remember to mail my check-in. When we were attending church in person, I was always that person that would frantically be writing out my check and sticking it in the envelope before the offering was passed. So with Simply Giving, you don't have to worry about it. So even when you go on vacation, your offering is still being given to the church. The third way is through our app, mobile app, Vanco Faith. So you can download this app and you can set it up either automatic giving, or you can just do it week by week, however you choose. That's it for me. Thank you so much for joining us. Now let's go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.